Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Hallelujah. What will we take this special request?
Yeah.
Once more.
Everything that life has to offer.
Amen.
And that's amazing. Can you say amen? With all the divorces and everything else going on in this world, God gave me someone that would stand with me.
Yes.
Through everything. Hallelujah. And that's just hallelujah. I praise God for you. That's right. Hallelujah. I remember we was having a pot party and she came through and I didn't know what she was doing, but she had gone in the other room to pray. And she came back out and sat down beside me and she was praying for boldness, that God would give her boldness to tell everybody about Jesus. And so she sat down there and she started telling everybody about Jesus, and about 2 minutes the pot party was over. Everybody felt like they needed to go home. And so they did. But I had to stay there under the same roof with this girl.
Hallelujah.
And that was the best thing that ever happened to me. But Dolly, you asked me to sing this song, so I'm going to do that. It's called I Want to See the One.
Yes.
Amen. And it's probably one of the most requested songs that I've ever done. I Want to See Him.
Preacher revival centers throughout the country, and
There was a whole circuit of revival centers across the country, and if you were very good at raising money, and if you were very good at preaching, and you had any kind of ministry, you could stay very, very busy in these centers. Some of them were great. Some of them weren't so good. The point is, as a young minister, I did a lot of things that I since repented of. I was taught by men who I thought were correct. They were my mentors. They were my teachers. So I thought nothing of it. But one day I got to reading the Word in areas, and it conflicted with some of the things that we did. So I stopped. I quit. And I asked the Lord, "Lord, what I do?" And you know, God loves us. When we do things in ignorance, if we do it out of a heart that means well, it doesn't make it right, but it does mean that God will help us. But if He tells us and we don't stop or turn around, then now we got a problem.
Yes.
Amen?
Amen?
So, money is not, as Brother Harris said, the biggest concern we have here. God will take care of all of that. Amen?
Yes.
And God will take care of you.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Yes.
I'm not going to get into that tonight in that sense of where I got another subject, but suffice it to say that the apostle said, as a man has purposed in his heart, so let him give.
Yes.
Not grudgingly, or out of necessity, or obligation, is what that actually means.
Yes.
Amen?
Yeah.
So when we give just because we love.
Yes.
And if we keep that attitude in our giving, God will always, always bless it.
Yes, He will.
It thrills me to hear of miracles that God does, like the one Jack just related. I knew it before, and when I first heard that, it blessed me. It blessed me again tonight.
Amen.
God has no lack of resources.
No, He doesn't.
He made the whole thing.
Yes, He did.
He owns the cattle on 1,000 hills, and one country preacher said, "The taters under the hills."
Yes.
Amen. So, praise God.
Amen.
It's always kind of a mixed blessing when you come to the last night of a meeting. It's joy and it's sadness. Because I see so many friends and people we've loved down through the years. Ron and Susie Burrow. Such a blessing to my life. I know, you know, I hear all the time how the ministry's blessed them, but they've also blessed me so many times and in so many ways. I remember in Puerto Rico when I called Ron one day and I said, "Would you come down and hold me a meeting?" And I knew that he was hurting at that time in his being from certain things that had taken place. And when he got off the plane and we took him to the hotel, he looked at me and he said something to me. He said, "You know, I'm not in top shape," something kind of like that. I said, "Brother, it doesn't matter. God can get you back in shape and preach in a while." I said, "God can get you back in shape right away."
Amen.
Amen. And I'm telling you, friend, He did. Because we had a meeting. And the Puerto Rican people loved Him. They couldn't understand some of the words and some of the things, but the music. Music is a kind of a universal language. You don't always have to understand the words to know what's going on.
Yeah.
And they loved Him. They talked about Him long after He left and remembered the ministry He brought to the island. Amen. This man has blessed me through the years. It's been a blessing. And it's another joy tonight to have Brother Mike Maston say,
yes, amen.
Also a man that I've known since he was very young in the Lord.
Yeah.
Ministered many, many years in the country of Australia, did a great work for God there, and is still doing a great work for God. here in the country. When he walked in today, I was just blessed when I saw him. And if I hadn't recognized his face, which I did, I would have known the voice. I would have known the voice. And these are the ministers, of course, but you, two friends that I've known and loved through the years, and new ones that we've made, pastor back here and his wife. We just love you.
Amen.
So it's always kind of a sad joy. Amen? Praise the Lord. All right. I want to get into the Word this evening. I told you I was going to talk about Genesis. Genesis is the key to the whole thing. What happened in the garden. It's the key. If you do not accept Genesis or understand it, you won't understand the rest of the book. You can't. Because it all goes back to the beginning. All of it. Words are very important. All my life, I heard the story of Genesis. How that Adam and Eve ate an apple or some piece of fruit, and suddenly they were wise, and they were thrown out of the garden, and blah, 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 which sounds like a myth. And this is exactly why it is rejected by a major portion of theologians. Do you know it was a theologian that started the God is dead theory or statement? He was a Harvard Theological Seminary theologian. He said, God is dead. We no longer need God. We've outgrown God. Therefore, God is dead. Theologian. They say the book of Genesis is a myth, and our detractors, atheists, and so forth, will argue the fact that, are you so simple-minded as you think eating a piece of fruit would make you wise? No, I'm not. But that isn't really what happened. If I would say to you, what is the fruit of the Spirit? Would you say an apple, or an orange, a grapefruit? Jesus said, by their fruit you will know them. What? How? You're going to bring them. Yeah, I'm going to bring you a basket of fruit and you'll know it. But that's it. So what's fruit mean? What's the fruit of the womb? Our children. We use that term a lot. And we're not talking about fruit. We're using it in a metaphor to explain something. This is what happened in Genesis. The book is very small. There is a scripture that says this and bears this out. The prophet said, I suppose if all the things that Jesus did were written, the world could not contain the books. We have a synopsis. Yes. That's all. But God lives in and outside this. Now, I'm going to shock you a little bit. Hang on to your seats. I've asked this of congregations all across America. Last night, I ministered to several people here, and I spoke to them concerning things in their life that God was telling me. And when I prayed for them, we saw visible miracles last night. What I say to them was that God's word that I gave to them? God was speaking to me. He was surely saying it. Was that God's word?
Yes.
Was it scripture? Why? It's no different. What do you think's written in there? The prophet spoke what God told them.
Yes.
I'm not saying we need to write a new Bible. I'm not saying we ought to add to it or take away from it. But that's a misnomer too. Because when John said, anyone that adds to or takes away from the words of the prophecy of this book, his book, not the Bible, just because it's put at the end, we think it's the whole Bible. No, he's talking about his book that he wrote, the book called The Revelation of Jesus Christ. That's what he was saying. God had unto him the plagues that are written in the book. Now, don't misunderstand me. What I'm trying to show you is the importance of something. We take the Bible and we almost make an idol out of it. Not that that makes the Bible wrong. It doesn't. The Bible's the greatest book ever composed. But God also speaks outside of it. Not against it. He doesn't disagree with it. You can go to the Word and find parallels.
Yes.
But God speaks outside of it. God doesn't just talk through the Bible. That's just a textbook to show us how to go and how to live and how to be.
Yes.
But it's a dead letter. The letter kills, but the Spirit or the mind of God makes alive.
Yes, yes.
I could have read the Bible to everybody last night. I could have just read you 4, 5, 10, 20 chapters of the Bible and closed it. And not one of those people would have went away blessed. I had to hear from God fresh. I had to hear from God tonight. See, when you have a need, you don't need to hear from God tomorrow or yesterday or 1,000 years ago, something that was written. I never have found my name in the Bible. Bob French isn't there. But God knows me. And he says, my name is written down.
Yes.
So evidently, it's there. Ron Burrell, I never read that. But I know God knows Ron Burrell, and God can say Ron Burrell, and God can speak directly to him outside of the book.
Amen.
It won't contradict the book.
No, it will not.
But it's fresh, and it's from God, and it creates life,
yes.
It creates blessing,
yes.
And healing, and deliverance, and all that we need from God.
Amen.
I've said for years, one of the saddest things in religion is they don't hear from God anymore. God's not talking to them. We got to get God to talk to us.
That's right.
I preached a sermon years ago, and God remembered Noah. What do you mean? What in the world? When I read that the first time, I thought, that's the craziest scripture I've read. What do you mean, God? Did God forget? See, that blows up all your theories about God knows everything all the time, anytime. Why'd God have to remember him? Left him out there over almost a year, floating around on that boat. I'm kind of like Bill Cosby sometimes. Lord, have you seen the bottom of this boat? Get me out of here. Bunch of animals on here. Whew. Man. But God went on his way and left Noah floating around out there on that water. And then the Bible says God remembered Noah. He went back to him when he needed to. At the time appointed, God remembered him. That's what we need to get God to do, is remember us.
Amen.
And by that I mean we need to stay in the place where we stay in God's memory.
Yes, amen.
We stay in God's mind.
Yes.
We do that by prayer and by staying where we need to be. In the will of God.
Amen.
Believing in him.
Amen.
So, the Bible is a tremendous textbook. But some people want to throw away the textbook. Can't throw away the textbook. You know, we do that in every other walk of life. You don't go into a math class and hear 2 and 2 is 18. It's always 4. It's a law. It stays 4. Can't be anything but 4. But let's throw the textbook away because after all, that textbook just messed me up. I want it to be 18. So we take the Bible. We say, end with the Bible. That's messing me up. Messes up my theory. Just throw that away. Don't need that. It's okay to do anything you want to do, whatever you want to do. Because after all, the Bible doesn't mean that. It doesn't say that. And so this is where we get to if we reject anything in here as just a story or a myth. Because it isn't. Moses knew exactly what he was talking about. He just said it very simply. You think about it. We sit down to our typewriters, our computers, our keyboards, and we can whip out letters, long texts, I wrote a book, didn't take me very long, said I needed a keyboard, but if I had to write it by hand, it would have took me a while. Moses didn't even have a good pen. He had a quill. Go out there and get you a duck's feather and try that out. And he had some parchment, or they were out there with a hammer and a chisel beating it into a rock. Well, you want to shorten the story down, or the scribe's going to wear out. Amen. So he shortened it up.
Yes.
The first verse of Genesis says this: "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth." Now the earth was formless and empty. Darkness was over the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. Now we think of that, as I said this afternoon, if you weren't here, we talked about the word spirit. The word spirit in Greek is pneuma. In Hebrew, it's ruach, or ruach. And in the Hebrew, it means many things like in the Greek. But one of the meanings that we fail to see and that they fail to translate it is mind. The mind of God, the will of God, was hovering over those waters. I can understand that. I can't understand spirit. I don't know what it is. I can't find it. Can't see one. But I can understand the mind. I can understand this all-powerful mind creating.
Amen.
We say that God created it all out of nothing. I have an interesting thing here by Jeff Benner. It's called The Living Words. And he's the Hebrew scholar that I really like. I love this guy. He was asked one time, the same thing, you know, if you don't have a degree, well, you're not smart. I used to work in the restaurant industry, and you know how many people I had waiting tables for me that had degrees? But they couldn't get a job. Because a degree in some things, it won't get you a job because there's no job in it. Unless you want to teach. You can teach the same subject, but as far as go get a job at it, can't get it. They asked him, "Where's your degree, Mr. Benner?" He said, "Well, maybe this past 40 years I've been studying this is enough."
Amen.
He's an intelligent man. Do you realize that Bill Gates didn't get a degree?
Right.
He dropped out of college. Borrowed $10,000 from his grandma and started Microsoft. Guy just flopped and fell on his face, didn't he? Because he was stupid. Really? Well, go out and try to buy any kind of software. I know, I'm sorry. I'm going to offend the Jackson Mac guy. In the movie they made about Steve Jobs and Bill Gates. And it was factual, a lot of it was very factual. The last thing that Steve Jobs said to him is, "I've got the best operating system in the world." And Bill Gates looked at him and smiled and said, "You don't understand still, do you? It doesn't matter. I know how to sell it. I know how to make it work." And he did. And if he hadn't bought half of Apple later in life before Steve Jobs died, Apple would have gone. It would have been gone because it was on its ear. So don't tell me a man can't be successful without a college degree. So he says this about the word create or creation, as it is in the original text in Hebrew, in the signs that they did. It was pictographs, the original language. Creation. The first verse of Genesis begins, according to most modern translations, "In the beginning, God created." According to most theologians, the word create is understood to mean to make something out of nothing. Right? This definition is an abstract concept with no concrete foundation and is therefore not a Hebraic concept because they were very concrete. To discover the original meaning of the Hebrew behind this English word, we will need to take a close look at the Hebrew word bara. The word behind the English word create, bara. In Genesis 2:7, it states that God formed man. The Hebrew word translated as formed is the verb yatsar. and is best understood as the process of pressing clay together to form an object such as a figurine. We can plainly see from this verse that man was made from something. However, in Genesis 1:27 we read, according to most translators, God created man. As we have discovered, man is made from something. Therefore, the word created in Genesis 1:1 and Genesis 1:27 cannot mean to make something out of nothing. If the word bara does not mean create, then what does it mean? By examining other passages where this word appears, we can begin to uncover its true meaning. 1 Samuel 2:29 is one of these passages. Wherefore, kick ye at my sacrifice and at mine offering, which I have commanded in my habitation, and honorest thy sons above me, to make yourselves fat, bara, with the chiefest of all the offerings of my people. Same word, created, fat. It's translated fat here. You say, well, it can't mean both things. Wait. Believe it or not, the word bara is translated as fat in the verse above and is the original concrete meaning of this word. What does it mean in Genesis 1:1? When it literally says God fattened the heavens and the earth. That's what it literally says. When an animal is chosen for the slaughter, it is placed in a pen and fed grain so that it can be fattened or filled up. This idea of filling up is now more relevant to the next verse because the land was empty and unfilled. With a better understanding of the word bara, we can now see the meaning of Genesis 1:27. And this is a mechanical translation. And Elohim filled bara, the man, with His image. With His image, He filled him. Male and female, He filled them. Image and likeness. The Hebrew word translated as image above is teslim, meaning an outline of a shadow, a representational image of the original. Once God formed the man, He filled him up with a representation of Himself. Wow. When I first read that, I absolutely almost jumped out of my chair. Dear God, it makes sense now. It's what I've talked about most of the time I've been here. We have lost image and likeness, and we have done it because religion has told us that we're nothing but a bunch of scum.
That's right.
Brother, you just, oh, you're low. You just, oh my God. God couldn't love man like he is. He's just a low down scumbag, not worth nothing. And so we begin to believe it. Faith comes by
hearing.
Hearing. Whatever you believe, it doesn't, it can be bad faith. Good faith comes from hearing the word of God, understanding it.
Yes.
Proper faith, exact faith. I talked about this afternoon in the words we went through. For God so loved the world, not hated it. He loved it. But we almost feel like God's at any moment just about ready to kill us. Both we just step out of line a little bit, or we just do this, or we do that. God just don't, because we're just flesh, and this old flesh, God hates this old flesh. He made your flesh. What do you mean He hates it? He doesn't like some of the things it does, or you let it do, but He doesn't hate you.
That's right.
He made you like you are, and He was proud of what He made.
Yes.
I created Him, and I filled Him up with my image.
Amen.
Male and female, He filled them. And we could have stayed that way had not Adam done what he did.
Yes.
But we need to go back. That's why Jesus came, brother,
right,
to fill us again.
Yes, hallelujah.
With His image.
Yeah.
Glory to God. I said He came to fill us again with His image.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
Yes.
Listen to it. Genesis 3. This is the story that we all tell. 3:1. Now the serpent, there comes from the Hebrew word hiss, a word that means hiss. So they translated serpent. Now I'm not going to go into all the things about that, but it wasn't a snake. It wasn't a serpent. It was a being that walked upright, talked, was intelligent, and he was not afraid of it. Because it came and talked to her all the time. And it wasn't one time. This was over a period of time. Just like God talking to Adam. I told him this afternoon, when God made Adam, he formed him out of the dust of the ground, the Bible says. Was he made with an intelligent mind? Was he filled with knowledge? Was he everything? I mean, did he get up talking and understanding everything and just... No. He was like an empty shell. Worse than a baby, because at least a baby has a little bit of going on, but Adam didn't even blink. And so God starts teaching him. He started talking to him. What was he teaching him? How to walk in his image. How to exist. How to live. How to talk. How to speak. Because it was given to Adam to speak to the creation. And he would obey him.
Yes, amen.
You say, oh, Brother French. Well, I know that the second man, Adam,
yes,
upon an occasion being in a ship on a troubled sea with the disciples, and they were so afraid that they had hid themselves in the bottom of the boat thinking they were going to sink. They wake him up because he's asleep. And they get him and they shake him and they say, Master, we perish. He comes up. He says, peace! Be still! And they said, what manner of man is this that even the wind and the sea obeyed him? Whatever he talked to, obeyed him.
Yes, it did.
Whatever he said, obeyed him. God was simply teaching Adam how to talk, what to say, and when to say it. He brought all the animals to him and said, name them, and they'll be called whatever you name them. Why didn't God name them? Whatever you name them. Why was the earth made? Why was it created? And who for? Man. This is ours. God made it for us. He made this whole thing for us. And we snubbed our nose at it and walked away. But God made it for man. You say, but the earth is the Lord's. Yes. And he can give it to whoever he wants to.
Yeah. That's right.
And he made it for you. And he made it for me. That's where we live. We can't exist anywhere else. Try out in space. It's hard to breathe out there.
That's right.
Not only did God make the earth, but this is the only self-contained spaceship in creation. In existence. You are right now traveling at a rate of 67,000 miles an hour around the sun. I have been around the sun 73 times in my life. We don't think of it like that, do we? The earth is spinning on its axis as well, and we're moving with it. And yet a plane can take off in Phoenix and land in Los Angeles, never having gotten a weed. Silly thing keeps falling on. No matter where. No matter that the earth is moving, but the plane moves with the earth.
You're dangling.
You fell down again, didn't you? Get a twist out. Tie that sucker on there. There you go. And we move with it. Isn't that amazing? And the earth replenishes oxygen, water, everything that we need to live while we've traveled all these miles around the sun. That's a spaceship. Self-contained, and it doesn't have a dome on it. We're not closed in. The atmosphere is the dome, and how it stays there, I don't know. Tell me what gravity is. Do you know what gravity is? I don't. They say, well, it's magnetism. No, it isn't. Because I'm not made out of metal.
That's right.
And the only thing I know a magnet will attract is metal, and it won't even attract gold or copper or brass or aluminum. I'm flesh. Now, I got a few metals in me, yes, but that's not what's holding me on this earth.
That's right.
And yet I know gravity works. I've tested it two or four times in my life. It worked every time. Broke everything. Always works. You get on a building, you jump off, I guarantee you it's going to work. It's kind of like a fellow that jumped off a building and somebody heard him going by the second floor saying, so far, so good. Well, yeah, so far, so good. That's the height, that's the definition of a real, true optimist. It works. So this serpent was more crafty, more sly, more subtle than any of the wild animals the Lord God made. He said to the woman, did God really say, you must not eat from any tree in the garden? The woman said to the serpent, we may eat fruit from the trees of the garden. But God did say, you must not eat fruit from the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die. You will not surely die, the serpent said to the woman, for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing function and dysfunction. The Bible says the words are good and evil, but they're not the original words. The original words in Hebrew are function and dysfunction. As I said the other night, the definition of good and evil changes around the world. What you call good, other people don't. And what you call evil, other people call good. So tell me which definition you want to use. I told this the other night. I used the example of something Brother Harris told me about witnessing an honor killing of a 16-year-old girl that had displeased her family by choosing the wrong boy. And they summarily stoned her to death. They stripped her naked and stoned her to death. If you asked them about that, they would say that was good. Her uncle, her dad would have said, that's good, that's normal, that's what we do. We can't let her get a bite of that. We cannot, it's a good thing. You wouldn't call that good. So now we got to mess with definition of good and evil, don't we? But function and dysfunction, you don't have any problem. That's the same around everywhere. Whole world, it either functions or it doesn't. It functions or it dysfunctions. And God said what he made function. Because when he said, and God saw that it was good. In other words, God saw that it functioned. It worked. Man was functioning for a while. He was functioning for a while. The word serpent there is lakash. It's a primitive root, probably to hiss, that is whisper a magic spell. Generally to prognosticate, divine, enchanter, enchant, learn by experience, diligently observe. Benner, in his definition of nokosh, to divine. Now we went into the word divine this afternoon. You would be amazing at the origin of the word divine. It's up there. Notice a couple of interesting things about divine. To distribute that is determined by light or magical scroll, by application to divine, soothsayer, divination, ancient, to practice divination, divine, diviner, use divination, prudent, soothsayer, divination, witchcraft. And yet this is what we attach to God. We call God divine. That's what the word means. That's what the word means, divine. We have changed the meaning to make it something that is good, but it isn't. That's not the original meaning of the word at all. What do you call somebody that divines for you? In the New Testament, there was a woman that followed Paul and Silas around and divined for all the merchants. But she was telling the truth. She said, these are the men of the Most High God come to show you salvation. My first pastor always said that the devil couldn't tell the truth. If it was the truth, it wasn't the devil. house. See, that's dumb. That's just dumb. Ain't no wonder the religious world's in a mess.
Yeah, that's right.
You can't fix stupid. It's hard, man.
That's right.
Ignorance you can fix, but stupid. Mercy. He was telling the truth that day. These are the men of the most. It's true. Come to show you the way of salvation. True. And the third day, Paul turns around and says, come out of her, you unclean spirit.
Yes.
Oh, all she was doing was saying good things about you. That devil come out of her. God set her free. And then the men of the city got mad at Paul because they lost their prophet maker. They lost their diviner. And they went after him, chased him out of town. He was running for his life again, just being blessed all over the place. Glory to God. You know, we can't stand if they call us intolerant. Oh my God, tell you intolerant. You unforgiving, bigoted Christians. Just shakes us up, scares us to death. So, what are we going to do with this word, divine? I'm not going to call God divine. I'm not going to attach that to God. Careful. This word, same word, corresponds to 17 different Strong's numbers. And this is the root word for all of them. Poro, fruit. And perine. The actual meaning of that is to trail or bull. Fruitful. The pictograph is a picture of an open mouth, and the next pictograph is a picture of a head. Combined, these mean open the head. The heads of grains are scattered on the threshing floor, a smooth, hard, and level surface, and an ox is led around the floor threshing the heads. Open to him to reveal the seed inside. Also the fruit of trees that harvested. Bull, with the exchange of the B and P, and the I and R fruit, also other fruits, and so on and so forth. But there are several. Bull, bullock, oxen, calf, young, is also the meaning of this word. Fruit. To break, throw something on the ground and break it by trampling, is also the meaning of the word. Fruit. Could also mean a skillet, anything in abundance. Could mean a decoration, a turban, goodly, brightness, fruit, fruitful. It can mean a wild ass, it says. All these things have the same word that they're interpreted from, the same root word. The one used in the King James is fruitful, increase, bear, or bring forth. That's what it means. So, here we are. We may eat of the trees of the garden. But of that one in the middle of the garden, we can't eat. What's going on here? What's going on here? Put up the word tree there, buddy. This is the word tree used in Scripture. Eights. A tree from its firmness, hence wood, pearl, sticks, carpenter, gallows, hell, pine, plank, staff, stick, stock, different tree wood. The word below it, excuse me, is a root. It's a primitive root, probably to fasten or make firm, that is to close the eyes or shut. Did you have the other one up there? It also means this. This is better in his interpretation of the original words. Firm tree, the upright and firmness of the tree. The upright and firmness of the tree, the elders of the tribe were the upright and firm ones making decisions and giving advice. Council, as the firm support of the community, Hebrew and Aramaic. Counsel, tree, counsel, purpose, advice. What was happening with Eve and that serpent? She was being counseled. Had nothing to do with that tree or a piece of fruit. It was the counsel. Hath God sinned? We'll die. No, you won't. No, you won't. But God knows in the day that you eat of it, eat what? Fruit. We eat the word of God. Yes. Scripture tells us.
Yes.
It's a metaphor, but we eat. We take in. She was taking in something that was opposed to God. And she believed the lie. And it went on and on and on for a while. It's one overnight thing. The word beguiled, the Bible says that Eve was beguiled. That word beguiled means that she was pressed continually. Look at it. Deception. The pictograph is a picture of a seed representing continuance. The next pictograph is a picture of teeth representing pressure. Combined, these mean continual pressing. An imposition such as the debt or deception which causes oppression. She was constantly pressed. How many times in your life has the devil tried to constantly press you?
Amen.
To get you to change your mind.
Yes.
Bring circumstances in your life that you think, God, I can't take any more of this. I just can't stand it, Lord. I can't take any more. And we're pressed on every side. She was continually pressed until she finally believed the lie. And she convinced her husband. And when she did that, God kept his word. He separated from her. But he said, in the day that you eat of it, not sometime down the road. You know, all the scholars say that, well, that means that death would come. Death would come, and if they failed, then death would happen, and then eventually they would die. And what it says, it said, in the day that you eat of it, you will surely die. See, when God spoke to Ananias and Sapphira and told them that they had lied to the Holy Spirit, he didn't say that you'll probably die sometime later on down the road. Ananias dropped dead right there. And when Sapphira came in and said the same thing, Peter said, behold the men, the feet of the men that carried your husband out. They're going to carry you. And she dropped dead. God didn't wait. When God said something, he meant it. And you either did it or you didn't. What happened then? What happened? God repented to a point, as he's done in the scripture throughout. He repented when Moses said what he said to him, and the Bible said he repented God. All right. What happened? God made the first sacrifice ever made. The first offering for man. He made them clothing out of skins, correct?
Yes.
Where do you get them? He didn't just zap them up. He killed animals. He made sacrifice. He made an offering for Adam and Eve so that he could allow them to continue. And even at that, their lifespan, Adam lived over 960 years. How did Cain and Abel know how to sacrifice if they hadn't ever seen it or heard of it?
That's right.
God never taught them to do it. But they knew it had been done through their parents.
Yes.
But then God did something. God put them out of the garden. And he set a cherub with flaming swords in the way so that they could not return and partake of life. The garden was a special place. Now, you can say what you want to, but it was. The rest of the earth wasn't like it. You know why? Because the Bible said, he didn't say God created Eden. He said God planted a garden. He planted it. And he called it Eden. And in that garden, he put man, and he came and his presence was there, and he dwelt there and talked to his creation on a daily basis. Well, anything around him lives. My son came up with something here a while back, and it kind of shocked me. And I had to think about it a while. We don't just automatically take everything each other says. Thought about it. But it makes more sense than the other way around. And I believe the Bible makes sense. I believe it makes exact sense. When God does something, when God is involved in something, there's always life there. Always. Can't be anything else. And the scripture tells us that no man can look on the face of God and live. Well, we take that if you look on the face of God, you'll die. No, that's what it says. Because if you look on his face, you live. He's the author of life. And God won't let you in this state. He's not going to let us do that. So God hid his face so that you couldn't see his face, because he knew if you looked on his face, you'd live. So God put him out of the garden so they could no longer see him. I read a lot of stuff. And I don't recommend it to everybody. And I don't think that some of the things I read are necessarily inspired or not inspired. Some of them may not even be true. But, you know, we have taken and we said, well, this is inspired, that's not inspired. The ones that decided that wrote some pretty crazy stuff. So I don't know if I can trust them or not. But nevertheless, the Bible got to us. But there are other things out there that you can read that are pretty good. And I read a book that I'd never heard of. It's called The Book of Adam and Eve. Some scholars say it's factual. Some say it's not. But I read it just to check it out for myself. See, I've never been afraid to read anything because I know what I believe. So you're not going to convince me otherwise, and something I read isn't going to convince me otherwise. I read it just to see if there's anything there that might be right. And so I was reading this. Some of it sounded spurious and funny, but I got to one place that really stood out. And when I read this, I thought, well, whoever wrote this, true or not, made a true statement. It was a true statement. He said that when Adam and Eve were put out of the garden, Eve went to her husband one day and said, "What's wrong with us? When we were in the garden, we could see the horizon. We could see the distance. We could see the water. We could see all of this." She said, "I can no longer see. I can no longer see." It's like the example I used that Seneca wrote about his servant. To see falsely is just as bad as being blind. God took away their ability to see. They could no longer see him. Because they would live. They'd live. And God said, "No, you're going to live in this state. Let's put him out of the garden." What did it say? "Let's put him and his wife out of the garden, lest they eat of the tree of life and live forever." Yes. "I will not allow it unless they see my face and they get life." So God no longer let him look at him. He no longer talked to them. There is a doctrine called original sin. It came out of the councils of the early Catholic Church. I'm not Catholic. Therefore, I don't believe it. Said, "Oh, Brother Bob, original sin. Everybody's a sinner." Not because of original sin. You got that scripture? It's all right. We'll get there. I had Brian do this earlier. I want to show you something. Did you have it? Romans 5:14. Look at that. Read it with me. "Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over them that had not sinned." after the similitude of Adam's transgression, who is the figure of him that was to come.
Oh my, that's a loaded verse, brother. I'm not even going to get into that last part of this, because you'd probably all get up and get some rocks, stones, come after me.
Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over them that had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression. Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. I don't know how close you have to walk to God to get that to happen, but it ain't happened to me yet.
Why, Enoch, he was a sinner, was he?
God took a sinner home then, without seeing death. It's not true. Progression of sin is not true. I'll tell you what is true. Separation.
Yes.
God separated himself.
Yes, he did.
That is all men.
Yes.
All men were separated. Some found their way back, like Enoch, like Abram. Like Noah. Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord because his generations were pure. And he found his way back. And God didn't deal with all a mass of people. He only dealt with just individuals at times. But some of these men didn't sin. Well, that messes up original sin. Wow. But separation came. God said, get out of the garden. He put the man out of the garden, and he separated himself. What was Adam's sin? What did he do? What was his transgression? He believed the lie. In the day that you eat of it, God knows that you'll be like him, and you will be able to determine for yourself function and dysfunction. Not only that, you'll be able to make the earth function. Because Adam was being taught to speak to it to make it do what he wanted it to do and to command it. God said, fill the earth and subdue it. Church. But when he tried to do it on his own without God, God said, no, you ain't doing that. You cannot make it. I taught a 12-week series on, I call it the Adam Syndrome. I have it online and I have it on CD, but it's a 12-week series, and I can't go into all of it here. It's called the Adam, but we're in the Adam Syndrome. Here's the Adam Syndrome. We're still trying to do it. We will build our world without God. That's what they're telling us all in our nation right now. We don't need God. We'll determine. We will determine right and wrong. We'll determine good and evil. And in the last days, the Bible said they would call good evil. We will tell the world we don't need God. God, get out of our way. We'll create our own world. And we will say what functions and what doesn't function. And we follow people like Dawkins and Hawkins and Immanuel Kant and others. We will decide for ourselves. You'll be like God. You can form your own function. No, you can't. God told him that. Where it says, cursed is the ground for your sake. What it actually says in the original Hebrew is God spit on the ground. God spit it on the ground and said, from now on, the earth will bring forth thorns and thistles, and you're going to find out that you can't speak to it anymore, and it isn't going to obey you, and you can't make it do what you want it to do anymore. Because I've taken it away from you. You are separated from me. And death reigned from Adam to Moses. Because God separated himself. And when Moses was talked to by God, it was the first time God opened the door to a lot of people, to Israel as a whole. And God spoke to him from the mountain. And what did they say? Don't talk to us anymore! Lest we die. Just tell Moses, and he'll tell us, and we'll do whatever Moses says. But they didn't, did they? It was just a way to get God to quit talking to them. They don't want to hear him. God tried to talk to Israel again. He tried to draw them in. He tried to love them. It's kind of like what Jesus said about Jerusalem.
Yes.
How often Would I have gathered you together as a hen gathers a brood, and you wouldn't come? I weep tears for you. Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you that stone the prophets and kill those that are sent to you. When Jesus was sent, God said, this is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased. Hear him. The words that I speak unto you, they are spirit. They are my intellect and life.
Yes.
They are words that bring life.
Yes, amen, amen.
We don't understand spirit. And what it means anyway, it means the mind. Words. What I said last night to these people was words. I didn't go up and say, well, let's get, I don't know, is there a spear around here somewhere? That wouldn't have worked. I had to tell them what God said. And when I told them what God said and they believed it, then something happened. Because it is a direct response to the Word of God. Anything that God speaks to lives.
Yes, it does. Mm-hmm. Yes, it does.
Anything that God looks at lives. Anything that gets around God lives because God is life.
Amen. Amen.
The author of it, there is no death with him. There is no death around him. You can't be in his presence and be dead.
No, I cannot.
The presence of God was in the prophet's bones. And they threw a dead man in the grave. And as soon as the dead man hit the prophet's bones, he revived.
Yes.
Because the presence of God was still there. We've got to hang with a narrative.
Yes.
And believe it. But when you really understand what it says, then it opens up the scripture to you. Man. He's talking. He's saying something. I've got a lot of notes here because I preach three or four messages out of this, so I'm going to have to calm it down. I'm just picking and choosing here because I don't want to wear you out. Now, I've already went through that, so here we go. I was particularly interested in something one of the commentators said that I like very much. I don't always agree with him, but I like it. Because a lot of times he really says great stuff, and that's Adam Clark. Wrote his commentary about 1834, somewhere in there. Old time guy. Uses Old English. How many have ever seen Old English? Have you ever seen it? Could you read it?
No.
I couldn't read it. Not real Old English, because it don't even look like our words today. Nothing. Words change. Words change meanings. We have changed it. But that's why we have to go back to the original word and find the original meaning to understand what it's saying. Because we've changed stuff now that we hear so much. And especially when they translate it into Greek, because then they got into the mythology. Adam Clark says this serpent was more like a crocodile or an alligator. As some say. Some say it was this and that and the other. But he says that if you go to the Arabic, and you look at the Arabic word that is used there. In Arabic, it's talking about something like a simian, ape-like. He said, we have to go to the Arab word because it's most similar to the ancient word. And it's more like an ape or a simian. In other words, what he's saying is, it walked upright, it spoke, it talked. And after it did what it did, it was cursed. It constantly pressed her. It constantly pressed her. Look at that. Philippians 2:6. Who being in the form of God thought it not robbery to be equal with God. Philippians 2:7. But made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant was made in the likeness of men. And that word likeness again. Jesus didn't think it was robbery to be equal with God. When Jesus called himself the Son of God, the Hebrews picked up rocks. The Pharisees picked up stones. You know why? Because a Hebrew wouldn't say that.
No Hebrew claimed to be a son of God. They didn't believe he could be. That was a blasphemy against God. And Jesus said, I'm the son of God. He said, no, I don't know. They were picking up rocks, brother. Had a pocket full of rocks. And didn't even think it robbery to be equal with God. Well, we talked today a lot about this. I can't go into all of it again, but we're family. We're family. In Genesis, where it said God made man in his image and in his likeness, let us go down and make man in our image and in our likeness. The word likeness there in the ancient word actually means blood. Blood. Likeness. What makes you like your father and mother? The DNA, right? Where's the DNA? It's all in your body, but it's mainly in your blood. If they can get a little bitty sample of blood, they can get your DNA. And they can do a lot with DNA now that they never could before. They can even tell what origin you are, where you come from, all that kind of stuff. It makes you look like somebody. Now, I know that I'm not trying to tell you that God put his blood in us. I'm not saying that. I am telling you, though, he likens it to that. We are blood relatives. Without the shedding of blood, there is no remission of sin. Without blood, you can't get anything done. Without blood, you can't look like anybody. There's no image and likeness. Mercy. See, I am so tired of the church being beat and stomped on and kicked on, and God's people being told they're dogs and nothing and you're so worthless, and boy, you just got to go in and bawl and cry and scream and holler and lay on the floor and wander around and try to get God to like you, because we're so bad. Tired of it. If God didn't like us, he wouldn't have gave Jesus for us.
That's right. Amen.
For God so loved us that he gave Jesus Christ. He loved us. He loves you. He loves you. He doesn't hate his creation. He loves us.
Yes, amen.
When are we going to learn that? That we're loved. We're not hated. Ministries that try to hold the people under their control and hold them so that they can manipulate them and do with them what they want for the benefit of them and for the benefit of an organization and for the support and sustenance of them. God wants his church to be his.
Amen. Yes. Amen.
It's his.
Amen. Yes, it is.
I'm just a servant in the kingdom. Amen. I serve you. That's why I came here to teach. I want to see God's people begin to do what they're called to do. Yes. I've had people come and say, Brother French, I don't have any gifts. What do you mean you don't have any gifts? That's why you don't, because you don't believe you do. Faith cometh by it. Hearing the right things.
Yes.
So, well, maybe you don't have the gift that I have, but I don't care. You have your gift.
Yes.
You have something that God's given you.
Amen.
And if we would act on that, we'd see a move of God in this country like you've never seen before.
Yes, amen.
I can't do it by myself. We leave it to the pastor to do. We leave it to the evangelist to do. No! It's the church.
Yes.
When I met these young men and this young man, I saw, and the reason I joined myself with what was going on is I saw a move of God. I saw the presence of God.
Yes.
In a bunch of kids, ex-drug addicts, didn't know one scripture harder from another, didn't know what any kind of theology was as yet, but just went out and started loving their friends, caring about them. Caring about them, ministering to them. You'd drive out through the woods in Prescott, and you'd see all of a sudden you see some lights, and you hear noise, and you hear a band playing, and they'd have a big generator out there going, and men are out there getting it, and the kids, and people everywhere! And they're making all the calls.
Amen.
They didn't even hardly know what they were doing, but bless God, it was working.
Yes.
And then it didn't take long for somebody to jump in and claim it for themselves. And eventually, drive it right down in the ground. A lot of us originals, not there anymore. I've been invited to leave a lot of nice places. I really have. Because I will not compromise, and I'm not going to say anything that I don't believe is what I should say. Why do we constantly destroy what God's trying to build? What is that about us? Or we want to put it in a cage and keep it so it'll take care of us. You can't cage this up. You can't cage it up.
No.
You can't keep it. You can't control it. You can't do anything with it but flow with it.
Yes. Amen.
Get in and flow with it.
Yes.
Amen. Go the way it's going. Pastor, remember that. Flow with it. Go with it. Get your people. Teach them that what God's got for them, they can do. And they can. And listen, man, ain't no telling what's going to happen.
Amen.
It'll explode, brother. That's what a revival is.
Yes. Yes.
And if we don't need revival, we're not dead.
No.
But we can go out and revive some that are.
Yes.
And get them alive.
Yes.
Bless God. Can you say praise the Lord?
Praise the Lord.
Jesus is standing at the threshold waiting for us to understand what happened. The world is separated. What we have to do is tell them you don't have to be separated anymore.
No, you don't.
Amen.
Oh, is sin there? Sure it's there, but that's not the problem. The problem is separation. Once separation is taken care of, sin is taken care of.
Amen.
It goes away.
Yes, it does.
You see, what we don't understand is forgiveness is already given.
Yes, it is.
Forgiveness is not something we're waiting on. It's already done. It's already given. All you have to do is repent and turn around, and it's automatically done.
Amen.
It's there. Yes. Forgiveness is there for you. Repent, and you're forgiven. It's just, you turn around, go the other way, and God's forgiveness is already there. It takes care of it. You don't have to beg and plead and cry. I know Christians that still feel guilty. We feel guilty about it. We can't even get over our guilt. Well, my God, I hear him pray. Lord God, if you could possibly use me anyway. Lord, I don't know, God. I know I'm distant. Oh, God, I don't know. God's not even listening. What he's telling you is get up.
Yes.
Who was the prophet? Come to me, and I can't remember the prophet's name. How my hair is going to lie. Lord help me. I'm going to go ahead and. But there was a prophet praying. And he prayed to God. He needed an answer. And you know what God said? God said, there was a prophet that went and prophesied against the altar of Bethel. Said, get up, shut up, and get up and go to the altar of Bethel. You're not there yet. You can't prophesy unless you go to it. Get up and go to the altar at Bethel and prophesy against it and say this. See, prayer doesn't serve everything. We use prayer as an excuse. Well, I prayed. Bless God, I prayed. I don't know. It's up to God now. No, it's up to you. You can pray till your lips fall. For some things, it ain't never going to happen. Because God is saying to you, get up and go do it.
Yes,
and
amen.
I'll meet you there.
Yes, amen.
Put your hand to the plow and don't look back and I'll meet you there.
Yes.
Amen.
Praise God.
Right, amen.
I can pray for this meeting. I can stay in Missouri and pray for it. Would have cost me a lot less. And it wouldn't have cost me that 1,452 mile drive in that car. There was a day when I wouldn't have thought of a trip like that, but boy, today I do. Because my backside doesn't take it like it once did. I can say, oh, God bless those people in Arizona, Lord. Just do something. And God would have told me, shut up. Just shut up. It doesn't matter. Get up off your backside and go. When you get there, I'll be there. I'll meet you.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
We use excuses. And we're taught that. We're taught, all you got to do is pray. Prayer changes things. No, prayer changes the things prayer is designed to change. But it doesn't change everything. Some things you got to do. Some things you got to do. That's all there is to it. God called you to preach. You just pray about it. How come? I mean, getting at the pulpit and preaching, you take a chance every time you preach, somebody get mad at you. You like people like you, don't you? We all like people like us, right? We all like people say, boy, Pastor, that was a great sermon. And then one comes and says, Pastor, I didn't like that at all. In fact, I don't think I'm going to stay. Well, you take a chance every time, don't you? Yeah. Well, just pray about it next time. Don't worry. Just, you know, get up the pulpit and say, we're going to pray, and that's it. I'm going to pray you understand, get some word in you somewhere. Bless God. But I'm not going to take a chance at it. Oh, glory. See, when you look at it like that, see? But that's what we do. It's exactly what we do. We're all praying for revival, but nobody wants to start one. See what these guys did? They started one.
Yes.
From the time that God sobered you up in that car listening to that gospel music, brother, you started something. But you didn't just sit around and say, well, that's good, praise God, that's good for me. You kept after these guys.
Yeah, he did.
They were running from you, too. They were running as hard as they could go. I said, boy, that burrow, we got to stay away from that guy. He's crazy. He don't know what happened to him. I don't know what happened to him, but that bugs me every time he gets around me. Every time. See, can't nobody claim that. Who, what preacher can claim that? No preacher did it. It doesn't mean that that takes away the need of the pastor or the preacher. That's not it. But we're not, I don't claim nothing. What am I? I didn't start nothing. All I did was go and preach or say something, and God did the rest of it.
Yes, amen.
There was a preacher that you heard on the radio. He was preaching. He was doing. He was paying for a radio broadcast. He was out there, wasn't he? But he wasn't in that car. And you know what? I dare say he never knew what happened that night in that car. And I know the man that was preaching. I knew him. He's going to be with the Lord. But I knew it. And I dare say he never knew that. You know what? If he's still alive, I'd go tell him. And you know what he would do? He would rejoice. Yeah. He'd probably have him up on the platform singing. Man, come up here and tell that story and rejoice with
yes.
me.
Yes.
Be shouting and dancing. Praise God.
Yes, amen.
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 We were separated because she was constantly pressed. She didn't eat a piece of fruit. She ate the wrong counsel. That's what we're doing at times. We eat the wrong counsel. There's men sitting right here that have been almost destroyed by that. But thank God they stood up and said, I'm not going to do it anymore. I'm not going to listen to the wrong counsel. I'm going to go listen to God.
Yes.
And God's going to lead me, direct me. Sometimes it's a hard thing to learn. It's a hard thing to do.
Yes.
It takes every ounce of our courage. Because many of these people that are giving us the wrong counsel, we love.
Yes.
And we care about. And we still do.
Yes.
We don't hate.
No.
But I can't listen anymore.
No.
I can't listen anymore. I'm going to have to go listen to the Father's voice.
Amen.
And do what He tells me to do. And do the best I can. How many times have you in your life been in a circumstance or a situation with someone and all of a sudden you thought to yourself, what in the world happened here?
Yes.
How did it end up like this? I mean, somebody's asking you to pray for them. Somebody's crying and asking God to forgive them. And you think, what did I say? How did this? I've been looking for this to happen for this person for years and all of a sudden here it is. Because you did something. Because God met you when you did it, and God got in it, and God took away the separation and the blindness and the darkness.
Amen.
And introduced Himself again to man.
Yes, He did.
God didn't want to separate Himself. The law wasn't even intended. It only came because they wouldn't repent. They wouldn't do any other thing. So God said, if you won't repent, then I'm going to do this and try this on for size.
Yes.
You're probably not going to like it, but that's what you asked for. God's always wanted to give grace. He's always wanted, he's always intended a relationship.
Yes.
Isn't that what we always called it?
Yes.
A personal relationship with Christ?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
It's personal.
Yeah.
When he comes and meets you.
Yes, sir.
And he says, hello, I'm Jesus.
Amen.
Get to know me.
Amen.
Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I'm meek and lowly in heart. Learn of me. Learn of me. How do you learn? By the words.
By the words. Yes.
So if I just stood up here and I looked at you. Well, wait on the Spirit to touch you. Praise God. Amen. Amen. You know, wonderful. Praise God. See how silly it sounds? Not that. No, I had to say something. I had to say something. I had to say what the Lord's given me to say. Why? So your life can be set free.
Amen.
And usher you into the thing that God has given you. He gave gifts unto men, severally as he will. Everybody have the same gift? I watched a man for years. His name was William Brown. Been in his meetings. I wish God would use me like that. I often prayed, God, won't you? You used me a little bit like that, but God wants you to use me like you did Brother Brown. Because I saw Brother Brown hit point to somebody in the crowd and say, would you stand up, please? You have, and he would use the medical term. You have such and such and such and such a disease. Is that right? I want to help you believe tonight. Is your name such and such? Yes. You live in such and such and such and such an address? Yes. You believe God will heal you? You believe God told me something about you? Well, there was no question. He told them their name, their address, what they did for a living, who their neighbor was sometimes. It was amazing what he would tell them. Saw a picture one time that was taken. This picture was given to the FBI to see if it was fake. And they said, no, it's a true photograph. It was a woman sitting on the front row of a meeting. And when they took the first picture, there was like a shroud over her, a black shroud. The woman was dying with cancer. Brother Branham pointed to her, called her out, told her, God touched her. And the second picture they took of her, the shroud was gone. Real picture. Not touched up. FBI said it's authentic. Not touched her. Shroud was gone, she seen it. And testified because she went to the doctor. I don't know what happened, but you're well. I've seen a lot of stuff in my life. You come too late to tell me God doesn't do things.
That's right, amen.
I've seen too much. I've seen God do it. I used to pray, God, give me your name, Lord. Give me your name. God says, shut up. Shut up. Just do what I tell you. You're not William Branham, so shut up. We hate it when God tells us to shut up. At least I do. I don't know about you. I just go. But he's not doing that because he hates me. He's done because he loves me. He's trying to teach me something. Like you teach your child. Son, hush. If you just do what I tell you, instead of crying around about it, it'd be a lot better off around here. See, God treats us just like we treat our children. Do you hate your child because you tell them right? No, you love them. But sometimes more you get exasperated with them. Kind of like, you know, in the honeymooners. Someday, Alice. Someday, to the moon! Feel that way about your kids sometimes, don't you? It's funny when you see your kids grow up and have kids of their own. I sit around and just laugh. Because they say, Dad, boy, Dad. Sweet, you see that. You feel good, don't you? It's
said, maybe I didn't do it wrong in the first place. Praise God. God is trying to get his church, you, not a building on the corner. God can't do a cotton picking thing, if you excuse a southern expression, with that building. It's going to crumble, decay, and fall away. And we meet in a building in St. Charles. It's to keep the rain off our head and cold out in the wintertime. That's all it's for. Me sitting out in the parking lot. But that's all it's for. There's no anointing on it. There's no blessedness in it. There isn't really ooh in it. I was in St. Peter's in Rome and almost got sick. Yeah. Walking around watching all them idols and watching all that mess. Yeah. Dear God. Showed me a pretty painting. And then he told me it wasn't a painting. Now here's the way we are. They said this isn't a painting because the paintings have been removed because they were being destroyed because people lighted too many candles under them. And it's ruining the canvas. So they took them down and put them in the basement. Said this is a mosaic. And I looked at it and said, dear God, that's better art. That's a better art than the guy that painted it. He did it with mosaics. It made it look just like the painting. Little bitty mosaics. They get you down, you look up like that, they shine a light on you, you see the mosaics. I said, wait a minute. Give me the guy that made the mosaic. He's got more talent than the guy that painted it. But, of course, that guy that did the mosaic is never going to be compared to the master. Why? See, that's what I'm saying. We say we can never, ever, ever be or do what Jesus did. Is that right? Jesus said, greater works than these shall you do, because I go to the Father.
Amen.
That's right. Amen.
He gave us permission,
yes,
to use his name. And he said he'd work with us and he'd do it. Amen. Whatsoever you ask in my name, I'll do it.
Amen.
But we don't believe that. We walk around, well, I can't do anything. I can't do it. I'm just God's poor little kid. And I don't want to ever, I just can't think about, I would be proud and presumptuous. Really? Jesus didn't think it was robbery to be his Father's son. Why do we? Why do we think it's robbery to claim the bloodline?
Amen.
Why do we think it's robbery to be in the image and likeness of our Father? We should look like him.
Amen.
We should look like him.
Amen.
Oh, praise God.
Amen.
Amen. When the church is going to learn that God wants you to, he's looking for some kids, for some sons and daughters that will act like sons and daughters. That's what he's looking for. Act like it. Go in all the world, he said, and preach this gospel to every creature. Go tell them that I'm alive. Go tell them I'm risen. I'm not a dead Christ on a stick of wood.
Amen.
I swear to my time, if Jesus would have been electrocuted, we'd all be wearing electric chairs around our necks. Honest to God, it's a shame and a disgrace.
Yes.
If he'd have been speared, we'd all be wearing spears. Well, he was speared. How come we're not wearing a spear? I need a blessed spear. Because they stuck one in him. Cross was an implement of death. And if you look at the Greek word for cross, it's stake. Steros. Stake. And the Romans had a nasty habit of crucifying people like that with their hands up over their head on one single stake.
Yes, they did.
Because you died worse.
Yes.
The lungs were filled with fluid. And worse. I don't know if I had a cross member. I don't care. I don't care about what he died on. I care that he come out of the grave the third day.
Amen.
And he appeared to many.
Amen.
Over 400.
Yes, he did.
And he said, I'm here.
Amen.
They come to find him and the angel said, why are you looking for the living among the dead?
Amen.
He's not here.
Amen, amen, amen. Yes.
Brother, where he is, there's life.
Yes, amen.
And we need to go and speak life.
Yes.
To everyone we find.
Yes. Amen.
Speak life, yes. Folks. God wants to use you. He loves you. It doesn't mean he excuses us if we get surly. It doesn't mean that he excuses bad behavior.
No.
He'll chastise you if you're a son. He'll chastise us if we try to walk a little out. Come here. Go here. But not because he hates you.
I know.
Because he wants to straighten you.
Yes.
Keep you in the path. And come on. Come up a little higher. Brother Harris and I were talking during the time we've been here. And he said, I believe, Brother French, that we need to enter into another dimension. And I agree with him. And we can do that. And you know what that dimension is? That dimension is when we really begin to believe in who we are.
Yes.
And friend, it will change.
Yes.
We will walk in another place.
Yes.
In another place.
Amen. Amen.
Lord, yeah.
Amen.
You know, it's been so precious. This meeting to me has been so precious because I have sensed the presence of God here.
Yes.
In such a precious way, every service. God's been so precious. So precious. Honey, go back to the piano, please. The reason that God uses ministry sometimes in the way that he does is, as the Bible says, it's to equip the saints.
Yes.
For what? So you can set the pew the rest of your life, just come and go. No. So you can do as the Lord would have you do. It's for the equipping of the saints. The reason that God has blessed people here and touched them and helped them is in the hope that they will take that blessing and share it with someone else that doesn't know about it, doesn't understand it. That I'm here, I am what I am because this is what God did for me. It's what a testimony is. Amen? It's what a testimony is. God wants you to be well. He wants you to live in health and peace. It's not always, it's not that we won't suffer persecution, we will. They're going to persecute you if you're a Christian.
Yes.
That's okay. Many of the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers them out of them all. A-double-L. God is so good. He's so good. Amen. He's so good. The Lord's been talking to me for the past few minutes, and I'm just waiting on. Sometimes God tells me stuff I'm not supposed to say to a person. And I learned that the hard way. I messed up a few times by going ahead and ministering to the person, and God didn't tell me to do it. He just told me about it. I don't know why the Lord does it. I don't know why. But I have to wait for permission in a way. It's hard to explain the way it works. Just believe me, it works out. And when God goes ahead and gives me a go-ahead and says, okay, you can minister to that. See, the gift works sometimes when I don't want it to, even. Because I'll be sitting somewhere and God will show me something about somebody and I didn't really want to know it. It's terrible. But it's okay. It's okay if you can handle it. Praise God. Some of you guys, I'm trying to get you to come to faith. I'm trying to get you to come because it isn't Bob French's faith that does this. It's yours. You're the one that touches God, not me.
Yes.
And God's just waiting to see if you really want to touch him. If you really want what you say you want. That's what he's waiting on. Praise God. But God's a specialist and he does special things.
Amen.
He does special things. Amen. Sister. Could I pray for you? You right there, though, not behind you, you. Bless your heart. God loves you. And you know it. Sure. Sure you do. But the Lord spoke to me tonight about you, and he gave me permission to minister to you. But this isn't in the sense of what we might expect. God has dealt with your life in times past and still doing it. But you have been bothered by some of the very things I've talked about tonight. Lord, I'm nobody. Why me? You've even had people say that. But the Lord's saying to you, when you're going to do it? When you're going to start? When you're going to start letting me work through you? Well, Lord, I don't know this. I don't know enough. I don't have enough knowledge. I don't have enough wisdom. No, that's not true. Because the Lord said he'd give us what to say.
Yes, amen.
If we fill our mind with his word, then he'll bring the proper word to our thoughts.
Yes, amen.
That we can use. God wants to use you.
Thank you.
Circumstances haven't always been good. And you've come through some tough circumstances in your life that scarred you. That left some scars, deep scars. You would tell me and people that you meet that you're over it. Because you believe you are, but in the quiet times of the evening and the night, sometimes the scars show. They show in your mind, in your heart, in your spirit, in your being. But you know what? God is going to heal the scars completely.
Yes.
He's going to take
Amen.
All the hurt away. The sorrow. Someone you sorrow for. And the sorrow has been so hard. The grief has been so hard. It's almost destroyed you at times. You are better. You're much better. God's helped you. But you need a complete freedom from completely. And it's God's going to do it for you tonight. He was just waiting for you to believe that.
Oh, amen. Thank you, Jesus.
You believe some of the things I've said tonight, haven't you?
Right.
Yeah, amen. Well, God specializes, and he's touching you in a special way tonight. God's going to anoint you with an anointing and cause a blessing to flow through you. And you're going to see people in your life that you have almost given up on, God's going to begin to turn things around.
Amen.
Because of your words.
Praise God. Thank you, Jesus.
He's going to get in those words, and he's going to begin to bless. I want to pray for you. Lift your hands up to the Lord and just worship God. Father, she's yours. She belongs to you. She's your servant. And Father, I ask, Lord, first for the healing in her life, in her being, in the innermost part of her, God, heal it up. And Lord, touch her in the thing that she has asked you for, enabling her, Lord, to be and do and say what she wants to be able to do and say, God, for you. I ask it in the name of Jesus and for your glory. God, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Yes, amen.
Oh, mercy. I'm looking at a couple of people tonight. If you could just turn loose of something inside you and believe, God will meet you tonight. I'm waiting on you. I'm waiting on you to believe something. It's not that you don't believe or have faith. I'm not trying to put you down. I don't mean it that way. But what I'm trying to do is get you to step over. Here's what's going on. See, you've been prayed for before. It doesn't seem like anything happened. So you say, well, what's one more prayer? What's one more prayer? But God is saying, I'll do it. He's waiting for you to believe. That's all.
Jesus.
Amen.
Jesus.
Because sometimes that gets to us, doesn't it?
Yes, it does.
We pray and we pray and we pray. See, that's what you're saying. something's going to be different about this one. This time it's going to happen. It's going to happen for real and for good. Oh, his presence is here. You sense that, don't you? When you got up out of that chair and just did what I asked you to do, you changed the course of some things.
Amen.
So you don't see a lot ahead of you worth anything. But it is. It is because God loves you. And God is going to begin to mend your path. Cause you to walk in a path that's right and proper. And the things that have tried to destroy you and hurt you and almost take your life, they're not going to do it. God ain't going to let it.
That's right. Amen.
Thank you.
He's not going to let it.
Thank you, Jesus.
Praise God. You've suffered loss in your life. And it just about destroyed you, just about killed you. And you don't see any reason to believe anything good will be. It's true, isn't it? But you did listen to me tonight. You heard what I was saying. And you said, you know, maybe there's hope. You're sitting there, you were sitting there, maybe there's hope, maybe there is something. It's different than what you heard before. But you said, wow. God's going to touch that part of your life and begin to give you beautiful answers and warning and heal you inside. The center of your being is going to come back together and you're going to quit grieving. And you're going to begin to rejoice. Not only are you going to stop grieving, but God's going to give back to you what has been taken away and what's been destroyed.
Hallelujah.
Not the same thing, but something better.
Thank you, Father.
God never gave Job back the same thing he had. He just gave him twice what he had that made it better. Glory to God. Not only that, you've been feeling this physically now lately. It's affecting you physically because it's been so long and it's just affecting you. You have no strength. You're tired all the time. Some of the organs in your body aren't working right. Well, they're going to start working right. You're going to get strength. You're going to quit being tired.
Yes.
And God's going to completely overhaul you from the top of your head to the soles of your feet. Put your hands up and worship God. In the name of Jesus. Spirit of the Lord. God. Amen. Amen.
Thank you,
Lord. Oh, God. My. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. Believe God loves you? Sure.
Yeah,
absolutely. He absolutely loves
you. Thank you, Jesus.
He absolutely loves you.
Blessed be the name of God.
Praise God. Healing from the hand of the Lord.
Yes, amen.
Thank you, Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Glory to God. There's no better grace. There's no greater sound than that. Somebody releasing it all to Jesus. Just giving it all to Jesus. The Lord won't forget you either. Come here. God remembers us here and there. Just like he remembered Noah. God remembered you tonight. Praise the Lord. You've been asking God for something for a long time. And you've almost quit asking because you thought, Lord, are you never going to do this? Are you never, ever going to do it? Yeah, he is. When you give up trying and let God do it. Okay? God will do it. He'll do it. Now, some of this is of a personal nature, and I'm not going to go into it.
Okay? You understand what I'm saying? All right. But God knows. God knows. God knows. You've been told certain things about yourself that disturbs you in the sense that these things could keep you from ever having the fulfillment in your life that you wanted and that you desired. Even a doctor has told you some of those things. Well, he may know what he's talking about now, but he ain't gonna know what he's talking about now, later. He might have told you the truth, but it's not gonna be the truth in God's economy. Because God's gonna change what the doctor said.
Amen.
And your body's gonna come to wholeness.
Thank you, Jesus.
I saw a couple of organs inside of your body that aren't functioning as they should. One's malformed. And God straightened it. God healed. God's fixing. And they're going to work right. And you're going to start feeling better almost immediately.
Yes.
You may have a day where your strength will have to come and the strength will have to come back. But most of the time you're so weary and sapped from this that you can't hardly go. Not anymore. Watch what happens tomorrow.
Thank you,
Jesus. Amen.
That's what happens.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Glory to God. Have I told
yes.
you the truth? Have you ever told me these things? Have you ever talked to me? I don't even know your name. Is that right? And the Lord didn't tell me either. Brother Brandon will have to keep that written. Glory to God. But it's all right. The Lord told you enough to where you believe, right? Do you believe it right now?
Amen.
Well, lift your hands and praise
Amen.
The Lord
yes.
and just be healed.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Thank you,
Glory.
Jesus. Amen, amen, amen. Glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus.
Glory to God.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
It happened.
Hallelujah.
Your prayers, He answered you.
God. Thank you, Jesus.
Now you go tell it.
Amen, amen.
You go share it. Get a hug in it. God bless you. You go and share it.
Amen.
Talk about Jesus.
Amen.
You know what? When somebody comes to you, got some problems like that, tell them. I'll pray for you right now. Lay your hands on them
yes.
and watch God work through you.
Yes.
Yes.
Glory.
Amen.
Amen.
Later for this giving a prayer request. Going to come in next week. I like what Brother Jack Coe said one time. He said, I don't want anybody coming and praying for me saying, oh God, if it be your will, heal him. And if it's not your will, Lord, he said, you never know. God might. I don't want none of that. If it's God's will. It's God's will that we're well. It's God's will that we're healed. It's God's will
yes,
that we're blessed.
Is.
It's God's will that these things take place.
Yes, it is. Amen.
It's God's will.
Yes, it is.
It's His will.
Yes, it is. Yes,
and we have to. We have to believe that. We have to trust
Thank you, Jesus.
Him. If we don't,
bless Him, your name,
then God is not obligated to do anything. But if you believe,
yes.
all things are possible
yes.
to them that believe.
All things.
Amen. Glory to God.
Hallelujah.
Oh, yes. Come on and leave it there. Oh, let's leave it.
saying that, the Lord released me to go ahead and minister to you. You came to this meeting expecting something from the Lord. Not only expecting, but needing something from the Lord. And the Lord spoke to me tonight and said, I'm going to meet him where he's asked me to meet him. And God's going to be there for you tonight. I'm not going to go into a lot of detail here, but God is going to answer some prayers for you that you've been really putting before the Lord because of things that, well, how shall I put this? Things that aren't satisfying to you totally. And you've asked God, God, help me find what I need. Help me find something that I can work in. Because God, you asked me a question the other night, and this is something he asked me, and I know this, but what God is saying to you is yes, he's put something in you.
Praise God.
And there is a gift there. There's gifts there. And there's ministry. And you haven't used it in a long time because you haven't had the opportunity necessarily. But God's going to put you back in the opportunity. God's going to put you back in, and he wants you to start saying it once you start speaking.
Yes.
Because God's going to put people in your way. It's going to be maybe different than what you think, but God's going to put these people in your way, and all of a sudden, you're going to realize, hey, this is the Lord telling me something. And you're going to tell them, and God's going to bring it to pass in your life. You've asked the Lord, use me, Lord. Let me be one of those, God, that can bless the kingdom. We live in a perilous time. But God's going to reach into that time and touch people that need us. They need you. And they need what God's put in those hands and what he's put here and what he's put in here. I'm going to ask God tonight to touch you with a special anointing. Like you've never known before. You may not feel anything. It has nothing to do with feeling. It has to do with the reality. That when you begin to minister to people and talk to them, you're going to see that anointing begin to break down walls and break down things in them and bring deliverance. That's what it's for. It's not to bless us, it's to bless those that we are sent to. I want you to just pray with me. Lift up your hands to the Lord. Father God, in the name of Jesus, Lord, you have something for this man and have given him something already. And Lord, you want to use it greater than it's ever been used before. As I lay my hand upon him, God, I release that anointing in Jesus' name. Lord, it's going to come as though it was part of him. As if it's just part of his being. In Jesus' name. Amen. 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 God is going to use you.
Amen.
God's looking for vessels. God's looking
yes.
for people
yes, he is.
That are willing, that see it, that are hungry. Yes. Say, Lord, use me.
Yes.
Yeah. Must be something here. Must be something here. Gotta be something. Praise God, gotta be something. And there is. There is. You love Jesus.
Amen.
You love Jesus.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes.
I gotta do one more thing. Praise the Lord. Brother, can I minister to you? What God told me is a little confusing to me, so that's why I waited. Not confusing in the sense I don't understand. Confusing in the sense that sometimes I don't know how to say something. So I have to think about it a minute. how to say what God's telling me. Sometimes God talks to me in ways that it's hard for me to figure out how to say to the person. But I want to start here. God put something in your life a while ago. And when I say a while ago, I'm talking about some time. And when he put that in your life, you understood it, you knew it, but you didn't know what to do with it. And when you went to those that you thought would be able to tell you, you got no answer in one way. And not much encouragement. But you knew God was still touching your life. You knew God was still doing it. And you've said, God, many times, God, just give me the door, give me an avenue, give me a way. Well, quit waiting on a way, quit waiting on an avenue, and just begin to use what God's given you. Use it wherever you find anybody or anyone. Let God use you. And God will touch. God will minister. God will speak. And God will cause a blessing. There are some things and some people in particular that you prayed. Now I want you to start talking. I want you to start declaring.
Amen.
I want you to start speaking. And watch God get in your words. And watch God get in the thing. And watch God's anointing begin to break down the walls in those that you minister to. Break them down. I mean break them. Break them down.
Amen, amen.
To the point of weeping, to the point of conviction, to the point of acceptance. Hallelujah.
Praise God.
See, God's calling ministry out. God's calling out his people to minister.
Yes.
Not just for healing and blessing and things, but for ministry, for things that God wants to do in them. When I lay my hands on you tonight, God is going to release something in you. It's going to be a point of contact where there's something's going to release in you that's held you back. It's not going to hold you back anymore.
Praise God.
All fear is going to be gone.
Jesus.
All the feelings of inadequacy, all the feelings of not being able, they're going to go. And God's going to enable you in the name of Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank
yes.
you, Lord.
Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Lord.
Jesus. Praise God.
Amen.
Amen. Brother Branham used to say, they don't sing songs right. He said, you know, the word's supposed to be come and dine. The master called it come and dine. But the religious world is saying come and dine. Come and dine. The pastor calleth, come and join. That's why he said join. You can have your ice cream socials all the time. We'll keep you well fed. But Jesus is saying, come and dine. The table is spread.
Yes, it is. Amen.
The table is spread.
Yes, it is. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Preacher, the Lord's got a word for you. This is just a word of encouragement because God's saying something to me tonight for you. Most of you, it's not necessary you know why or the background or anything. It's not necessary. It's that he knows. You don't show it and you don't talk about it, but inside you, there's a place that you haven't been able to overcome. And it troubles you when you're quiet, when you're alone and by yourself. Part of that is some grieving that's still there. Part of that is, what am I going to do? It's not that you're not trying to do something. You are, and you're ministering. But you want to see the fulfillment of what God promised you and what God gave you. The devil would tell you, oh, it's over for you, boy. But it's not.
No, it's not.
just begun. This man was a very successful ministry in Australia for 30 years. All of a sudden, his whole world, his life has been changed and turned around. But God just pointed him in another direction. You're going to begin to speak words and speak life like you never have before to congregations and to peoples. And God's going to begin to develop in you that ministry that you've always felt was there and wanted, and it's going, and you've done it, you've practiced it, but it's going to come in more power and in more fullness in the name of Jesus. God's getting us ready.
Amen.
God's getting His church ready.
Yes.
God's getting His men ready.
Yes, He is.
Man, we're not through. We're not even started yet. Glory to God. Well on the road, brother.
Yes, amen.
Well on the road. Amen. Glory.
Yes, amen.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord.
Blessed be the Lord.
Yes, blessed be His name.
Blessed be the Lord.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Glory be to God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Glory to God. Oh, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Ron, the Lord told me to pray for you. I know what is bothering you. I know what troubles you. That's not the point. But the Lord told me to pray for you. So that's what I'm going to do.
Amen.
Ron has some conditions in his body that caused distress and pain. Last night, he had a spell where he got real dizzy. He left the service, went out and sat in the car. He didn't leave because he didn't want to be here, but because he couldn't understand that or sit up. And he had no need to be there. We don't know what caused it. Don't care what caused it. We just want the Lord to take it away. And that's what he's going to do. I'm going to pray for it right now.
Yes, amen.
God's going to touch him.
Yes. Thank you, Jesus.
If God ever did it once, He'll do it.
Yes, He will.
Amen. And He's done it.
Yes, He will.
Praise the Lord, Father. In the name of Jesus, I bring my brother before you, Lord. God, you told me to pray for him, and so I do it. I obey you, Lord, and in the name of Jesus Christ.
Yes, God.
Let's be healing, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, this dizziness, whatever's causing God, it's no more in the name of Jesus. Man, we used to sing an old spiritual. We said, Lord, I'm running, trying to make 100, 99 and a half won't be. Amen. And then we'd change it up and say, help me, Jesus, to make 100. Because 99 and a half won't do. Lord, I'm running. I'm trying to make 100. Because 99 and a half won't do. Oh, help me, Jesus, to make 100. Lord, 99 and a half. Oh, I thirst, Jesus, help me, Jesus. Oh, help me, Jesus. Oh, I thirst, I'm hungry for life. Oh, help me, Jesus, make a money for life. Help me, Jesus, make a money for life.
Lord, I'm running, trying to make 100, 99 and a half won't do.
There you go, that guy's man.
Lord, I'm running, trying to make 100, Lord, 99 and a half won't do. There you go. Lord, I'm running, trying to make 100, 99 and a half won't do.
Yeah.
Here we go. I used to lead singing. Early days, that's how I started that. See, but you can't dance on a rug. That's hard to dance on a rug. You got to have a wood floor to dance, praise God. That's hard. Come on up. If you get out of intense, you can dance a little bit.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord. Amen. You know, people say I danced in the spirit. I didn't. I just danced. Didn't need the spirit to make a dance. The Bible said Miriam took a timber in her hand, yes, one of these, and went out and made dances before
people. Yes, she did.
They danced and rejoiced. Yes. David danced when he came into Jerusalem with the Ark of the Lord behind him.
Yes.
Amen.
And he danced violently. He's clothed.
Yes.
He's wearing a robe. Yes. And he's flying up, and his wife up in the window saw him. Shamed him. Yeah. Said, how dare you uncover yourself in front of the young maidens of Israel? David said, I'd yet get more vile if I thought it would please God.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And God cursed her till the day of her death. She had no child. Whose side do you think God was on?
Yes.
Whoa, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. I'm about to get mercy. Amen. When I see the Lord do good things, I get happy.
Yes, amen. Yes.
I get happy.
Yeah.
Amen. Amen. You know, there's a way to sing a song and there's a way to sing another one. You know, people that they sit around and they, like Amazing Grace. Now, I love Amazing Grace the way it's sung, but you can also sing it like this. You can sing Amazing Grace, Lord, how sweet is the sound, and sing. I can't help it. I did.
Choir, man.
Oh, yeah. Gene Martin. Gene could sing. Gene went home to be with the Lord recently. He did. He was a song leader for Brother Allen for many years. Young black man that loved the Lord. And, oh, Lord, could he dance?
Oh, wow.
I've got many albums. Yeah. Many. I've got old 78 or 33 and 3rd RPM albums. Vinyl. I would have bought me a record player so I could play them. I got a bunch of them. Brother Allen loved color. So they're not black. They're red, orange, all colors. And on that, Gene's singing, packing up. Getting ready to go. I'm packing up, getting ready to go. And it's a very fast song. And I probably don't have the breath to sing it, but he's singing, packing up, getting ready to go, packing up, getting ready to go. And he started dancing. He'd say, you'd hear him go, whoop, and he wouldn't be singing no more. You knew what he was doing. You could hear his feet on stage.
That's the music God. We were listening to that night in that car.
Amen. Yeah, that organ. Amen. Tommy Anderson at the piano. Buford at the organ. Glory to God. Listen, friend.
I'm telling you, man.
It's time to... That's time for a shout to be in the camp.
Amen.
Yes, amen.
I said, we need a shout in the camp.
Yes. Amen.
We need victory in the camp. Yes. We need joy in the camp.
Yes.
We weep all through the night, but joy comes in the morning.
Yes.
I said, joy comes in the morning.
Yes.
Glory to God.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Yes.
I'm going to get my... I'll be preaching black style here. Because I love it. Glory to God. I used to preach in black churches, and they told me, said, I had my black brothers just come, especially some of the sisters. There was a woman in Oakland, California. Her name was Mother Self. The black ladies, they're mothers.
Yes.
You call them mother. That's respect.
Yes.
It is.
Yeah.
And I, Mother Self, she's a big lady. And she'd see me come in that door, and she'd say, preacher, come over here and get yourself some loving.
Yeah.
And I got it too. She hugged you, you're gonna lose your breath. Boy, she can hug. But I loved her. She was a dear lady.
Hallelujah.
She loved me. I loved her. She said, she'd tell me, she said, Brother French,
Are you sure? Are you sure you don't have black somewhere in you? I said, honey, I probably do. And if I do, it's okay. Amen. Some of the greatest meetings I ever had was in black churches.
Yes.
I love them. Amen. I love them. Praise God. I love them.
Yes,
amen. Amen. I can go that side. I can preach like a white man. Now, I never did preach black in a black church because some of them would have thought I was just putting it on.
Yeah.
And I wasn't going to offend. I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to do that. But some of the pastors were teasing with me after the service and said, Brother French, surely you can preach like this. I said, yeah, I can, but you know, there's a couple of people out there looking at me kind of mad. If I tried that, they'd probably get up and throw me out. Then they'd laugh. We had a great time.
Yes.
God loves people.
Yeah, that's right.
You know, I don't know why we make such a big thing over color and race. If you're like Brother Harris and I, or Brother Masson, Brother Ron, we preach to people all over the world.
Yeah.
You know what I find? I find people to people.
Yes.
From the mountains of Chiapas and the Cholon Satal Indians,
yes,
to the Middle East, to Africa, to wherever you go, to Mexico,
yeah,
wherever you go. These beloved people were in our services at Chandler. They were in our congregation. And I love them. Dolly used to make us great tamales. But she always tried to get me to eat menudo. And I told her I didn't like menudo. Because I don't like tripas.
She's still trying.
And everybody tells you that their menudo is better. Theirs is the best, see? Well, I've ate it all. And I still don't like it. Now, there's one soup that I'll eat a tub of it. I'll see it eating it. Too much. And that, what? I forgot the name. It's made with a big hominy. Pasole. Pasole. Deme mucho pasole. Glory to God. I love the cultures of other people. I love to learn them. I've had many Mexican people come up to me and say this. They say, Brother French, when you come to Mexico, you're different than some of the other ministers that come because you always find an example that's Mexican. You find something in our country that you like, something that's beautiful here, and you refer to that in your messages. Yes, I do it on purpose. Because there are things there that are beautiful. There are things there.
Amen.
And I like the country I'm in.
Amen.
I've always enjoyed Mexico. It's a beautiful country. Amen. And beautiful people, beautiful culture.
Yeah.
I remember going up to Tumala, and you could drive as far as you could drive, literally. I'm telling you, we were in a four-wheel drive pickup. Brian was in the back. They had stakes up on the side, and they're hauling people. I'm sitting in the cab with a little Indian woman and her baby and the driver. He's in the back in that truck standing up. It's leaning over so far in those ruts that his face is nearly on the ground. Then it's coming back up. The door on my side of the truck, it was twisting so badly, the top of the door would snap out that far. And the windshield in front would lift up out of its place. And then it would snap out. I was glad to get on the horse. Because we drove as far as we could, and then we got on a horse. I hadn't ridden a horse in years. Rode that sucker 4.5 hours.
It wouldn't have been so bad if we wasn't on the side of the mountain.
Yeah, it was on the side of the mountain on top of it. Listen, listen. This is a sad thing, but many of the Satal Indians and the Chol Indians, they get killed picking coffee. Because they grow it on the sides of mountains. And they literally, it's kind of like the old farmer joke about the Arkansas farmer, where he come to town one day and he was all bandaged up and he was all hurt. And the guy said, Zeke, what in the world's the matter with you? He said, I was plowing and fell out of the field. That's an Arkansas joke. Because in Arkansas, the fields are like this, rambling around the hill. Well, in Mexico, they literally, I've
I've talked to women there that are widows because their husband literally got killed picking coffee, and that's their trade. But here we are in the little village of San Antonio, Chiapas, Mexico, in the mountains. Sitali Indians are about this tall. Little bitty people. Precious. They were so glad that we came. They had a little chapel built. And it was built with a thatch roof. It looked like a hut you'd see in Africa. It had just stakes in the ground, rough wood planks. It was spaces between them about like that. Down the middle of that, they had a wire, and on that wire was three lights, three light bulbs. And they had that hooked to a battery, a 12-volt battery, one of the old-fashioned big ones. And the way they got that battery charged, because there was no electric in the village, they would take that battery, and one of the little Indian men would take them. They're these bands. They put it on their forehead, put it around the battery on their back, and carry it with their neck all the way. Walk 4 or 5 hours into Tupelo, get it charged, and carry it home, so we could have light that night for the service. I had the greatest time ministering there. And those people that had stayed with me all night long, they weren't in no hurry to go nowhere. We want the Lord. After we went in, sat in the little thatch hut, and talked to the folks, they brought the battery inside and hooked it up to the one light bulb hanging up there so we'd see one. Those are the great times. Those are the great times where you learn to love folks where you find them.
Amen.
Of all colors, races, and creeds, it doesn't matter. Amen. We're all one in God. God made us all
one. Yes, He did.
We're one in God.
Yes.
We should try loving one another instead of hating one another.
Yes.
We should try that. It works.
Right.
Amen? Praise God. God is so good.
Yes.
God is so good. And I enjoy all cultures. I enjoy people. I enjoy being with them. I enjoy living with them and seeing their culture. Seeing what they're about. Amen. Doesn't mean I have to give up mine. They don't have to give up theirs. Because Jesus loves us where He finds us.
Yes, He does.
Can you say amen?
Amen.
All right. It's been a joy. It's been a joy. I hate to always come to the end of something. But every time there's an end, there's a new beginning.
Amen.
What I hope is that from this meeting, you will take what we've said and go be who God wants you to be.
Yes. Yes.
Let it spread, folks.
Yes.
Let it spread. You can stay in touch with us. You can stay in touch with Brother Harris. There's information back there. If you want to know where we're at, what we're doing, if you want to be a part of the ministry, you can be that. I'm not asking you to take away from your place of worship where you go. That's not the point. But we're all in this together. We're all in it together. Let's help one another.
Amen.
Not fight and quarrel with each other. I'm not after your folks. Lord, why can't we get over that stuff? I'm just after the kingdom's benefit.
Amen.
That's all.
Yes.
Let's benefit
Praise
the kingdom
God.
Of God.
Yes.
Let's be the people that God Praise wants us
God.
To be.
Yes.
Don't fall for the lie. Hath God said? Yeah, He said.
Yes, He did.
He said. So let's do it.
Yes, He did.
Let's do it. He said it. Let's do it. I love you. I care about you. We'll continue to pray for you. Would you please continue to pray for us?
Yes.
Remember us in your prayers as we fight the fight.
Yes.
Brother Harris, his work in Iraq, friend, you want something to support outside of what you're doing already? Do it.
Yes,
I tell you, do it. I commend it to you. He don't ask for anything. I can't hardly get him to take a dime when he comes down here and preaches for him with me. I say, here, I don't want nothing. I made him take something last night. Stuck it in his pocket, wouldn't take it back. Wasn't much. But dear Lord, that's not what we're about. It's not what we're about. This is paid for whether you give a dollar or not. Doesn't matter. Our congregation paid for it. Now,
We took an offering so that we can replace what we can. And that's what we'll do. It'll just replace what was spent. If it replaces it all, praise the Lord. If it doesn't, I'm not upset. It's okay. Praise God. Because we love you. We wanted to come and do this. We wanted to do these things. Hopefully, in around March of next year, we're going to be in the Northwest with Brother Harris up in the Northwest in Washington, in the Tacoma, Seattle area, doing this same thing. Pray for us.
Amen.
We're trying to stir people up all over the country where we can go and where we can be into this same thing.
Yes.
Let's get in this thing.
Yes.
Let's move it forward.
Yes.
Let's be the people of God.
Amen.
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 Good to see you. Ron, you're a blessing, brother. You bless me. When he sang my song the other night, I sat there, I had to fight back the tears because that song just touches me. It always has. And when he sings it, nobody like that. You can't nobody sing it like him. Not to me, anyway. But it's a blessing. Susie, his precious wife. I've known these guys since they were kids. You know, I call them kids. They were kids. They weren't kids, but... They were young. We all were, weren't we? And it's such a blessing, Dolly and Margaret. John, part of our congregation in Chandler. My brother over there, God bless you. The new acquaintances here, pastor and his wife, his sister, you, my sister sitting there, Leon and Diane Schlauterbeck from Prescott. People from Flag, I never met you before that I know of. If I did, I forgot. Forgive me. But anyway, God bless you. I'm so glad you
came. We met last year.
You were here last year?
Yeah, we were here last year.
Okay.
Right on Peoria, the other home.
Yeah, over at the plaza.
Yes.
You know where you were. Now you're familiar to me. Okay. You know, I thought, well, he does, but no, I don't know him. You know how you do. Well, see, there I should have stuck with my first assumption. Praise God. Well, thanks for coming back.
Absolutely.
Praise the Lord. Appreciate you. And God bless all of you. Mike, you're a blessing, brother. You're a blessing. Amen. I'm so blessed this time. I don't know what's happening, but I'm just full. You know? And of course, this guy over here, he blesses me, he amuses me, kicks me on my toes, shares insight with me. I pick his brain, and it's a good brain to pick. Because God's given him a lot of insight and a lot of knowledge. When I heard about the minister in Iraq, I said, nobody but Jack. I said, I know it's Jack. Ain't nobody else go there but him. He go anywhere. Glory to God. All God has to do is tell him, and he's there. He's gone. Listen, you don't realize maybe how, you know, it's not that we don't sit around and think about this stuff. I heard Rabbi Zacharias say this. He was speaking to a group of Muslims in the Middle East. These were all Muslims and they weren't Christians. They weren't people of anything. They were businessmen and all kinds of stuff. And he had to speak to them. He said, let me tell you something. He said, for a moment, I hesitated. He said, literally, he said, I went to get a drink of water. He said, my hand was shaking so bad, I couldn't make up the glass. Because he said, I knew if I stood up and said one wrong thing, I'm a dead man. But he got up and said it anyway. And he talked about Jesus. And they accepted. What was it, Brian? He said, one of the Muslim chieftains came to him.
Oh, he was visiting a sheikh.
A sheikh.
And they were close to the mountain where Abraham,
yes.
He said, not too far from here is a mountain where Abraham took his son. Now, they think it's Ishmael. He said, we're not going to get into that. But he said, but you revere it, I revere it. He said, but the thing of it is, that same God that Abraham talked to sent a son. And he said, until we accept that son, he says, we're all going to continue to lose our sons and daughters on the battlefields of this world. And he said, when he got done, he didn't know how that shape was going to take that. But in the end, he said that shape finally come around. He said, with big tears in his eyes, kissed him on both cheeks and said, "You're a good man." And walked away.
Unless we accept the son that God sent, our sons and daughters are going to continue to die on the battlefields, and they're going to shed their blood. The old sheikh came and kissed him on his cheeks and said, "You're a good man." It's true, isn't it? It's true. All right. Stand with me. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Let's have a prayer together as we conclude this service tonight. Let's pray together. Have you enjoyed this time in the Lord?
Yes.
Amen. I've had a great time tonight. Amen. Give the Lord a hand. Father, it's with a thankful heart that we come before you this evening. Lord, we're not closing this meeting. We're not closing what we're doing. We're just going on and continuing to do it. The services may end for this time, but Lord, what you're doing isn't ever going to end. It's not ending. We're going on, and we're going to do your will. Bless everyone, God, that's partaken in this meeting. Use them, God. Let the gifts of God be in them. Let them come forth in power and anointing. God, cause your presence, Lord, to move throughout this city and throughout the other cities represented here. Let the church begin to do what it's supposed to do. The body of Christ. The fulfillment of your word. In Jesus' name. Bless each and every one as we go from this place. Keep us in your will, in your presence, in your strength, and in health that we're able to do the will of God. I ask in the name of Jesus and for your glory. Amen. God bless you. Shake someone's hand, hug somebody before you go. Amen. Fellowship with